Today the message is called Reach the Lost at Any Cost. The last time I was here, what did we talk about? Be great. We talked about being great, and we talked about the Great Commission, that God has called us all for this Great Commission to go out and make disciples of the nation to people and bring people to the Lord. So today's gonna be radical. It's gonna be very encouraging and really opening our eyes to what God has in store for every single one of us, because Jesus Christ is coming. And the world's in it's just crazy, crazy, crazy times, you know. A lot of crazy stuff happening. So let me talk about what we're gonna do today. So we're gonna talk about Jesus reaching the lost at any cost. We're gonna have a day in the life with Jesus. I mean, he's the one that we look to get our influence and to follow. He's the Lord of our life. And he reached the lost literally at any cost. And what was the cost? It was his life. He died on the cross. He got sent on a rescue mission out of eternity to come die for you and for me, because we're sinners, saved by grace. Amazing. So here's Jesus living the Great Commission in the world, not of the world. He's in it, but he's not partaking of the things of the world. And we have a lot of friends and family that are not believers. And if they're not believers in Jesus Christ, Jesus says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And if they don't have that relationship with Jesus Christ, they're not on their way to heaven. And that's a very scary thing. A lot of you guys that have, you know, experienced crazy things in your life, you know that the enemy is real. And he's looking around the world, looking to whom he can devour. He's on a mission to devour us. But that's why greater is he that's in us, Jesus Christ, and he that's in the world, and through the power of the Holy Spirit. So here's Jesus in the world, not of the world. We're gonna talk about Jesus, talking about in Mark 2, where Jesus is in a home Bible study. And then later on, he goes out to the lake shore and he goes out and preaching to the lost. And then he does like a one-on-one street evangelism, finds Levi. And then he goes out and hangs out with notorious sinners. Like, these guys must've been real sinners, because in this text, this is like the only place in the Bible, in the New Testament, there's a couple other places in the gospel where it talks about like these were like notorious sinners. All the other stories is like Jesus was with the multitudes. He was in the temple. He was out preaching. But this says these were like sinners. So I'm like, what are these guys like? Then I started thinking about my life. Oh, this must have been my crew. Definitely my crew. And I started thinking about, what's my crew like? Well, I remember reading that story about the Wolves of Wall Street, right? You guys ever read about those psychos? Those guys were gnarly. I'm like, yep, Jesus entered the room with these dudes for sure. So here we go. At this time in Mark 2, the religious leaders, the Pharisees, were very critical about Jesus, and they were trying to find fault with him. They were on a mission to find something wrong with him that they can accuse of him. So right now, up to Mark chapter 2, I'm gonna give you a little overview. You could turn to Mark chapter 2. That's what we're gonna go through the first 17 verses today. Mark chapter 2, chapter 1, Jesus gets baptized by the Holy Spirit. Remember John the Baptist, what I was talking to you about last time I was here? He baptizes him with the Holy Spirit. That Holy Spirit in Acts 1:8, it says you will receive power when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. Jesus is on a rescue mission. He's going for the lost, for the sinners. So number one, he's like, I need to get baptized. Boom, Holy Spirit comes on, descends on him like bodily form. The Father God says, this is my dearly loved Son who brings me great joy. You have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit working together. Then he is led by the Holy Spirit, or in another gospel says that he was driven by the Holy Spirit. When we're in tune with the Holy Spirit, God leads us and guides us and drives us to situations to talk to people or to be at the right place at the right time. He was led by the Holy Spirit to the wilderness where he was praying and fasting. He's like, I'm gonna do God's will, but I need to be prayed up and fasted up and be ready, because it's gonna get crazy out there. And that goes for all of us. If we wanna reach the lost at any cost, we gotta be prayed up, we gotta be baptized, and we gotta be fasted up and ready for war. And guess who showed up there immediately after? Satan. Lucifer showed up and he tried tempting Jesus. He wanted to disqualify Jesus immediately before he started his public ministry. And so some of you guys here that have gotten involved in ministry, you're like, I'm gonna serve the Lord. Who shows up immediately? Satan. He wants to get you disqualified. He tempted Jesus with the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, and the lust of the flesh. But what did Jesus do? He battled them with the word of God. And that's how we fight Satan, is with knowing the Word of God. When we get those crazy thoughts, or Satan puts us in a weird situation, the Scriptures will come back to our remembrance, and God will speak to us. The Holy Spirit will speak to us right there, so you will not get disqualified. And so you'll be able to overcome the evil one. So that's what Jesus did. Then immediately after that, he went to the temple and he started teaching. And it says he taught with real authority. People were like, we've never heard any teaching like this. Who is this guy? And then on top of it, some demon manifested. And he's like, shut up, get out of here. Leave. Casting the demon out of this dude right there on the spot. People were just like, who is this guy anyway? You got to understand, the religious system was broken since the last book of Malachi up to 400 years to when John the Baptist came up on the scene. It was a dead system. God put the Pharisees, they were like the priests or the teachers of that time, and he put them in place to, they were basically the farmers, to take care of the land of Israel so that the people, which were the trees, that they would produce fruit in a sense, right? Spiritually speaking, that they would nurture them, they would water them, they would prune them, they would make sure that they were producing fruit, but they got corrupt. Remember, we've talked about that. They were corrupt. They were ripping people off. They were all about themselves. They were like, Jesus says, you guys are like whitewashed tombs. You look good on the outside, but your hearts are corrupt. So here Jesus is preaching with authority, casting out demons. Then on top of it, he decides to make a little pit stop. He's led by the Spirit to go to a house to pray for Peter's mother-in-law. She was sick. You know, when God leads you, hey, go over to what's his name's house, go talk to him, or go pray with him, or just love on him. Here's Jesus. He's left the church. He's doing a little pit stop at a home. He prays for her, heals the mom, then she cooks him a meal. Then they heard, I mean, his fame's growing. People are like, who is this guy anyway? So it says that many sick and demon-possessed people were brought to the house. So Jesus comes out. He's always moved with compassion, starts praying, starts healing people. So now those people go back to their towns. There's like a ripple wave effect going all the way to Jerusalem and the other surrounding towns in the Sea of Galilee. We didn't have Instagram back then, so it's all word of mouth, you know. And you had to go to different cities for different, you know, products or whatever to buy and sell. So it's growing. Then what happens is he basically goes out by himself and he starts praying to God, because he's like, okay, God, what's the next direction? You know, there's signs and wonders happening, but what does Jesus do? He goes back to praying. So signs and wonders, praying, teaching, signs and wonders. If you're praying, fasting, and in the Word of God, signs and wonders will follow. That's biblical. Don't just go after the signs. You know, there's people that are just chasing the signs and wonders always. There's a balance. Read, pray, fast, signs and wonders. It just goes down. You know, recently, you know, I got a text message actually, yes, or a direct message on Instagram a couple days ago, and there was this girl, she came to Shine, and we teach the Word of God. That's what I do, right? And evangelize. Teaching the Word of God every Thursday, this girl comes up, she's walking with a dog, and I'm like, hey, what's up with the dog? You know, like, she's like, well, I have seizures, and they took my license away, court ordered, and I have to have this dog, you know, until I get healed. And so I was like, hey, let's pray, right? Let's pray and see what God wants to do. Dude, we prayed for her. Now, 3 years later, she texts me, or sends me a direct message, and she says, hey, you prayed for me at Shine 3 years ago, and I had the chronic seizures. And she goes, I just wanted to let you know I got my license back. She goes, I haven't had seizures since that day when you guys prayed. And I was like, amen. God, it wasn't me. Who am I, right? It's God. And it wasn't like I'm like, I got the gift of healing, you know. I'm just like, look, dude, let's just pray and see what God wants to do. And that is for all of us. If we're in the Word, we're reading, we're praying, God will use any one of us. And I don't know if I've ever healed anyone. I don't know. It doesn't even matter. It's Jesus is the one that's like, all right, I'm going to demonstrate my power because I love this girl. Ryan, I can care less about you, buddy. I love this girl. And I'm moved with compassion. I want to see her healed. Boom. And he just touches her life. So that's basically what's going on. God, Jesus' fame is growing. He's praying. He's getting God's direction. Then after that, he starts preaching again. He goes out through a mission through the Sea of Galilee. He's out, and they used to call this the Sea of the Gentiles. The Sea of the Gentiles was non-Christians. It was the world. And what was Jesus doing? He was going around, doing his tour around the Sea of Galilee, and then on his way back, he came across a leper. Like my dad says, leopard. Leper. He had leprosy. And hey, the leopards are everywhere. See, I say that because you guys know my dad. We all love my dad, obviously. Ryan, don't say that. Shh. All right. So he saw the leopard. Now I'm saying leopard. The leprosy guy. And he says he was moved with compassion. And leprosy was an incurable disease. So he walked up and he touched the man and he healed the man right there on the spot. So now Jesus's fame is even growing even more. Healing someone that has an incurable disease, it's like sin. Sin is a type of leprosy in the Bible. It's a type. You look at leprosy in the Bible, it's like sin. Sin is incurable. And as Jesus comes into your life and he touches your life and takes out the bitterness, the anger, the drugs, the alcohol, the greed, all these different things that we war with, he starts removing this, your porn problem. He starts taking those things out and Jesus healed this guy. So now the fame is growing with Jesus and everyone wants to know what's going on with him. So now we're going to pick up in Mark chapter 2. So it says this, when Jesus returned to Capernaum several days later, the news spread quickly that he was back in the house. In the King James Version, it says that Jesus was in the house. Now, what news? The news about the Nazarene. The Nazarene, the faith healer, this guy, Jesus from Nazareth. People are like, who is this dude? So the news is spreading that this guy is tearing it up and healing people and casting out demons, and he's preaching with authority, and people just want more of this stuff. Dude, he's on fire, right? So going on in verse 2, it says this, soon the house where he was staying was soon packed with visitors that there was no more room even outside the door. Well, we know that we just talked about that he did a tour through the local area of the Sea of Galilee, which there was like, you know, towns around it. He did that tour. He came back to town. So people, when you're healing people and preaching with authority, people want more, right? So now the place is jam-packed. It doesn't say how many people were there, but people couldn't fit inside. It was packed. And even outside, I want to say there was hundreds, if not thousands of people surrounding this house just to hear a word from Jesus, or maybe they could see him, maybe he could touch him, whatever it is. But this group of people that were there was thinking, what kind of people are there? There's the seekers, the people that are looking for truth, just like there might be people here tonight. And you're looking for truth. You're looking into Mormonism. You're looking to Hinduism. You're looking to Buddhism. You're looking to Catholicism or Judaism or Christianity or you know, Satanism. I mean, who knows, right? But you're looking for truth. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. You want to reach God? That is the gate. He says, narrow is the gate to heaven. Narrow is the road. But wide is the road to destruction, to hell. And many find that road. Jesus is the way. So you have the seekers there. Then you have the spectators that are just like, dude, every time I see Jesus, he's just, it's amazing. We got to go just check him out, taking their friends to come check Jesus out. Then you got the spies, which were the religious leaders, the Pharisees of that time, the guys that were corrupt. They were just trying to find fault with Jesus and they were critical. And it's, you know, once you become critical, it's hard to come out of that. You think everything's critical. You start, well, I know Greek and I know the Greek word and Hebrew, and knowledge puffs up, and this is the only way you're a Christian. This is the only way you're going to get to heaven. All these other guys doing outreach, like the whosoever's that are going into these dark places, they're on the highway to hell. Heaven's going to be very small with you if you really think that you're the only one that's going to make it and you found the only way. There's going to be all kinds of people in heaven. And those people that are hating on you know, certain people that are going out and reaching the lost, your mansion's going to probably be right next to ours in heaven. They're going to be like, they made it to heaven? I can't believe this. Yeah, dude, we made it. And there's these Pentecostals over here, your other neighbor, some Lutherans or some Catholics. There's all these different people that love Jesus, and they're all in your neighborhood. You're right in the middle of us for eternity. Ha ha! Sucker! So you have the spies. You have the sick people that wanted to be healed by Jesus. And then there was just the people that are like, who is this Nazarene that's rocking the whole religious system? Who is this guy? We want to know. So the house is completely packed. And then going on, it says this, while he was preaching God's word to them, four men arrived carrying a paralyzed man on a mat. And here Jesus is again. After the signs and wonders, what is he doing? He's preaching the word of God. So the house is jam-packed. He's preaching the word of God. And then these four dudes showed up with this guy. And I was sitting there in my house thinking, what's up with these dudes? The Bible doesn't really say much about them. So I started thinking, okay. Well, the one thing I know about these guys, they love their friend desperately because they carried him. He's paralyzed. And we know that, we're going to get into the story a little bit later, that this man was paralyzed because of sin. His sin got him to this place. So I'm like, all right, was he like, I'm thinking about situations like me. Okay, well, did he get in a bar fight? You know, and someone get a stick and just crack him in the neck, paralyzed, you know? boom. I mean, that could happen very easily. I've been in a lot of bar fights. Or, you know, what, you know, or did he, what did he do to get him in this situation? But we know this, whatever it was, his friends loved him so much that they carried him on a mat. Now, Jesus did a tour all through the Sea of Galilee and all through the neighboring areas. So how far did they carry him? Did they carry this guy hours away? Have you ever carried dead weight? Do you know how heavy like someone is when you're carrying someone miles away or hours away? They're carrying this friend. They, and I don't know if they're all friends or they're family members or whatever it is. They know that this dude has been in this situation and he's been tormented. He's depressed. You know, he needs help to go to the restroom, to get a drink, to get food, to see the sunlight. I mean, he's dependent on these people and it's because of this sin. But their friends loved him so much that they decided that they were going to bring him to Jesus. Because who knows if Jesus touched one of their friends and healed them, or he preached to them and God touched them and they believe in him. Whatever it is, Jesus had an impact on these four friends. So they went on a mission to bring their friends to Jesus. And I started thinking about, do we go on a mission to bring our friends and family to Jesus? These guys love their friend. Do we love our friends that we will do whatever it takes, break our back, in a sense, to bring our friends to Jesus? So here they are. They couldn't bring them to Jesus because the crowd, so they dug a hole through the roof above the head, and then they lowered the man on the mat right down in front of Jesus. So these guys have real faith. These guys show up, and you see thousands of people, hundreds of people, and it's packed. And now they're holding their friend, put him down. They're like, dude, it's gnarly. My back's going out. You know, like, it's been a long time for us to get here. Now it's packed. How are we going to get into Jesus? All right, guys, let's load up and let's go back. Let's take it back the other way. Heck no. They're like, we're going to get him to Jesus. Have you guys ever been in a situation, and I'll just talk about my past life, where you want to get into a concert and it's like sold out? Or better yet, like me, I had no money to get in. What do? You break in. You sneak in the back. You jump the fence. So these guys show up. They look. They're like, we can't get in. Okay, let's strategize. All right, they get together. All right, man, look, we can go up the roof. Why don't we just go up the roof and just break in? What do you think about that? How are we going to get up there? We need rope. Let's go to the neighbors. Did you bring rope? I didn't bring no rope. I didn't know we were breaking and entering. Hey, look, this is like governed by the Roman officers, right? So we can go to jail for this stuff. So let's make this thing fast. So they go to the neighbor's house, you know. This is Peter's, you know, neighbor or mother's house. You know, Peter's staying there. So, hey, can we get some rope, man? We need to use your rope. And maybe, do you have a ladder? You know, we got to get to Jesus. The neighbor's like, you guys going to break in? Yeah, give us a rope. Dude, if Peter knows, he will come out and knock me out. Peter's gnarly. Well, I'm not helping you break into Peter's house. Have you seen that guy? And the disciples he hangs out with, those guys are nuts. There's no way. Dude, just give us the rope. We'll bring it back. You're going to tell Peter nothing. All right, here, take it. Take the ladder. Just keep it. Go, get out of here. I'm not home. Turn off the lights in the house. Actually, it was daylight, so it doesn't matter. Shut the blinds. So they go. They go around, you know, ladder. I don't know if they had a ladder, but they had rope or something. They had to get them up. Their friends had to scale the roof. They probably have the other visitors, like, hey, get the guy up there. So they're helping lift the guy. And I don't even know how they tied up this guy on a mat. I mean, was it like on all four corners and they all just grabbed a corner? Or did they just wrap them around the rope to the mat? You know, I mean, I don't know. Like, these are all possibilities. So now, here they are. Pulling them up, they're sweating dead away. Get them up here. The other people that are there helping them get them on the roof. Then they get to the roof and they're like, now what? They're like, start digging. You know, those houses are made out of adobe. It's like, you know, some of the houses out in New Mexico. So they get up top and they're like, we got to dig through. Now, I don't know about you guys, but to get someone wrapped up in a mat through the roof into the floor, you have to make a huge hole. Have you ever thought about that? That's a huge hole. I mean, how much time did it take these guys to dig through adobe? So here they are, Jesus is teaching. It'd be like we're in here. The house is jam-packed. All of a sudden, you start hearing noises. And you're just like, Jesus already knows. He knows all things. He's like, what are these dudes doing right now? He's like, all right, I'm ready for them. So he's teaching. All of a sudden, you start seeing like the adobe dust coming through. It looks like an angel coming through because the sun's coming through. And there's no angel. You just see these hands coming through. People are like, what is going on right now? These dudes are breaking and entering. Like, this is insane. They start breaking and entering. They're looking down at Jesus sweating. Like, hurry up, dude. We're about to go to jail. Peter's just like, these dudes are done skis right now. These fools are breaking into my mom's house right now. So probably telling the sons of thunder, hey, dude, let's get them on the way out, right? So Jesus is like, chill out. So they start breaking through. Jesus is like, hey, dude, everyone get your whatever you have, sash, put over your face for the dust. Then they start lowering him down. Like I said, how they lower him down? Is he all tied up or whatever? I think maybe they lowered him down flat, and he's just laying there. And you know, he's coming down, so he's kind of like looking over, like looking at Jesus. Jesus is like, he's like, these guys. He's lowering down, looking, and as he passes Jesus, he starts looking back up at Jesus to the floor. He's just kind of maybe all laying there, all tied up to the thing, looking at Jesus. This is what Jesus says. He says, Jesus, seeing their faith. They didn't say anything. He just sees them. He didn't say anything, but he saw their heart. Seeing their faith, he said, my child, your sins are forgiven. It's amazing. When we give our life to Jesus, we're children of God. We're the children of the Most High God. And this guy is in a horrible place in his life mentally because of the sin that got him there. And Jesus is like you're with me. He's like, child, you're my child. Your sins are forgiven. And even though that dude was probably stoked because of the situation that he was in, his friends were like, are you kidding me? Sins forgiven? We are not pulling this dude back up, loading him up, and carrying him all the way back across town, Jesus. We need our boy to walk. Sins are forgiven. We don't know what these guys are thinking, but we know that this dude that was laying there, you know, a lot of Bible scholars that teach this text, they believe that this dude caught syphilis, an STD. And the progression of syphilis, you catch it, you sleep with a guy or a girl, whatever it is, you get syphilis, it attacks the brain, and then it slowly attacks the nervous system, the body muscles, and then you become paralyzed. So we don't know how long this guy was wrapped up being paralyzed from this sin, but every single day that he woke up, right when he'd open his eyes, he'd be like, why? And then at night and at day and just day after day. So when this guy heard Jesus say, my child, your sins are forgiven, that is the best news ever. Jesus is addressing the main problem. If you're here, I've had people come up to me and go, Ryan, pray for me, man, that I could stop drinking or stop using drugs. And I could pray for the guy, and if God took away the drugs and alcohol, the guy, he's a sober sinner still. The problem is forgiveness of sins. We need our sins forgiven. We need to have a relationship with Jesus Christ so that we can go to heaven. It's not about being a sober sinner. If this guy goes, hey, get up and walk, go back. Then he's like, okay, I got away with that one. I'm going to go back. This time I'm going to be a little bit more careful, right? I can relate to that. I don't know about you guys, right? We can all relate to that. So Jesus addresses it and says, my child, your sins are forgiven. And then in verse 6, it says, but some of the teachers of religious law who were sitting there thought to themselves, what is he saying? This is blasphemy. Only God can forgive sins. They're wrong and right. Blasphemy, they're wrong because Jesus is God. But forgiveness of sins, they're right. God can forgive sins. Jesus is God. Knowing, Jesus knew immediately what they were thinking, so he asked them, why do you question this in their hearts? These guys didn't say anything. These guys thought that, and can you imagine? These guys are like, this is blasphemy, I can't believe this. And Jesus immediately looks over and he's like, what? They're like tripping, like, what? How did he know? How did he know what we were thinking? Who is this guy? He's Jesus, he's the Son of God. That's why he healed the leper. That's why he could read your mind. That's why he can forgive sins. He is Jesus Christ, the Messiah. So these guys, these Pharisees are tripping out. And here you go in verse 9, it says, Jesus says, is it easier to say to the paralyzed man that your sins are forgiven or stand up and pick up your mat and walk? Well, I can go here and look at this guy and go, hey, dude, your sins are forgiven. Well, that's if I was Jesus, right? Well, you can't see that. You can't see sins being forgiven. But if I were to say, hey, your sins are forgiven, pick up your mat and walk, you're healed. Well, now that's going to demonstrate that I am God, that Jesus is God, because now the guy's got up and he's walking. His sins are forgiven. He's walking. It's a thing that you see. So he's like, all right, what's easier? Did I just say your sins are forgiven and stand up your mat and walk? Obviously, to stand up. So he goes, all right, guys, I'll prove it to you. Then he says, I'll prove it to you that the Son of Man has the authority on earth to forgive sins. Then Jesus turned to the paralyzed man and said, stand up, pick up your mat, and walk. And here Jesus is proving that he's God, and he just closes his deal with three strikes. First, he proves I can forgive sins. Second, this is not blasphemy. And third, he's walking. Boom, just threw it in these religious people's face, but they're still hard-hearted. They're not getting it. They're not comprehending because they're caught up in their religion. Then in verse 12, it says, and the man jumped up and grabbed his mat, and he walked through the stone onlookers, and they were all amazed and praised God, exclaiming, we've never seen anything like this before. Jesus' fame is growing more, and now you have these religious people. These religious people are like, these guys remind me of the guys that are on the internet, you know, that are just writing blogs and writing all this stuff. And even though God's moving, they're just writing all the stuff. But Jesus, now here he is just going, Duke, he's walking, he's healing. Just like us, you're seeing these people coming out of crazy backgrounds, finding Jesus, and now going out and being missionaries. We're seeing this stuff. These guys, Jesus heals them right here in the middle of everyone. And this guy, I love it because it was so jam-packed that this guy had to really take his time to actually maneuver. He has his mat, and he has to weave in and out of a jam-packed house. And you know Jesus is looking at the Pharisees just like, what? I told you. I'm the Nazarene that everyone's been talking about. I'm the Son of God. And you guys still don't get it. Look how slow that guy has to walk out here because there's so many people. Just take the next 15 minutes to watch this guy walk out. He is walking. He's been forgiven of sins. He's walking. I'm the miracle man. And my name is Jesus Christ, the faith healer. So the guy walked out, picked up his mat. He's like, I'm out of here. His friends are like, whew. We didn't have to carry him back. Thank you, Jesus. You know, they're probably like, sorry, Pete. We'll send you some money to figure out this roof deal, right? He can walk now. He can work. So he'll pay you back. You know, your friends leave you with the bill when you go eat. He got you. He got you. Going on, it says this in verse 13. It says, then Jesus went out to the lakeshore again, and he taught the crowds that were coming to him. So now Jesus leaves the home Bible study, and he goes out to the world, and he's preaching. Remember, this is the Sea of the Gentiles. And we have to remember, you guys, Jesus told us to be in the world, not of the world. A lot of us, we come out of the world, we get born again. Jesus separates us so he can clean us up. But then we got to go out. But a lot of people get stuck and they become fat sheep. Well, I know all the Greek and all the Hebrew, and man, I'm pretty dang good. And I know the right way, and everyone else is in sin. But they never go out and reach the lost. It's good to get built up. It's good to know that stuff. But Jesus gave us the Great Commission. Remember, it's all about reaching the lost. And these are the things we could use to talk to people of what we know. But look at Jesus. He's in a home Bible study. Then now he's going out to the lakeshore. He's teaching people that came to him. He would love on them and teach them. He was moved with compassion. Verse 14, it says, as he walked along, so now as he walked along, he saw Levi, son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax collector's booth. Follow me and be my disciple, Jesus said to him. So Levi got up and followed him. So now Jesus is walking one-on-one ministry in the street. He's spirit-led. He's in tune. God shows him. He says, I do whatever the Father tells me to do. He sees Levi. And you know those people, when you see it in their face, that they're empty. Levi, this dude is a baller. He was a Jew. He worked for the Roman government, and he was a taxman. Israel was a major highway between Europe and Asia to Africa, import, export. So he worked there at Capernaum at the desk, and they would, it was like a toll tax, you know, they would tax him. And the Roman government, what they would say is they'd say, and this is just a number I'm throwing out there. Hey dude, you gotta bring in $10,000 a month for us. Anything after that is yours. What are you gonna do? If you aren't a Christian, you're gonna rip people off. This guy's been ripping people off, and we know he hangs out with tons of sinners. So here he is, he's ripping people off, getting drunk, doing whatever he's doing. And he's, you know, these poor parents. If he has to make quota, you got this mom coming through with their kids, poor farmer. He's like, he's taxing them. He has to pay his bills, right? So he's not happy about the situation he's in. Jesus obviously sees it, and he says, hey, dude, follow me. And it wasn't like the other disciples, they were just fishermen. They were common folks. They weren't balling it up, you know what I mean? So he basically, what he left was a nice paying job working for the government. So he left everything. He counted the cost. He walked away and followed Jesus. And I love this. Jesus probably looked at him, and it's true because he changed his name. You know, he's like, Levi, that life, that's your old life. You know, we have nicknames from our old life. You know, you have those like, because you were like a lunatic and you have like a crazy name. Like, hey, they call me the Beast or like Rock and Roll Ryan or like whatever it is. Just like out of my mind, crazy guy. The Beast, my brothers named me that. Right? It was like off of like wild boar, you know, like that kind of a beast. So I was just nuts. So basically, His name's Levi, and Jesus is like, I don't like all that past life. I don't want you to remember all that stuff. I'm going to name you Matthew. And you know what Matthew means? Gift from God. How amazing is that? He's like, nah, that old stuff, that's all done. We're going to, you're gift from God now. You're with me. And he wrote Matthew, and God used him. Huge, right? Amazing. And that's what God does with all of us. He throws that old life. You know, we learn from that, but we're not, we don't look back because we're not going that direction. We're going forward to Jesus. So then in closing, we have a couple more verses that says this. Verse 15, later Levi invited Jesus and his disciples to his home as dinner guests, along with many tax collectors and other disreputable sinners. There were many people of this kind among Jesus's followers. And when you read through the gospel, you hear Jesus was with the multitudes. He was out, you know, everywhere he was at, they would just say the environment he was in, but they never said he was with these tax collectors and disreputable sinners. Like, this crew was busted up. This was like a sketchy crew right here. So when I, like I said, when I started reading this, I'm like, okay, here's Jesus being in the world, not of the world, hanging out with the Wolves of Wall Street guys. I mean, dude, he's sitting there hanging out with these guys, must have been bad to the bone, like craziness, right? So verse 16, it says this, but when the teachers of religious law who were Pharisees saw him eating with tax collectors and other sinners, they asked the disciples, why does he eat with such scum? Such scum. And I get, you know what, my heart, seriously, my heart breaks when I, when we're literally, any of us, anyone around the world that's going out and trying to reach the lost, and people come against you. Why are they with there? How can they be there? No light and dark. Clearly, have we read the scriptures? Jesus wasn't going along with this, but he was that light in that dark place. And when you go to the darkest place and you're that light, it shines bright. And your friends are going to watch you. They're gonna probably step up their game and drop more F-bombs. And people are like, they cuss the F-bombs and this. And what world do you live in? Like, that's everywhere. That's everywhere. Are you guys scared a little? Like, are you scared to go hang out with your friends and bring them and let your light shine because the way they talk? You would rather them like, well, they're in hell now because I didn't want to hang out with them because, you know, they say the F words a lot. Who cares? I'm not getting defiled by that garbage. I got the power of the Holy Ghost in me. I'm there. I'm just letting my light shine, loving on them. And here Jesus is hanging out with them. And these Pharisees were driving themselves crazy because they go, why is he eating with such scum? Because back in those days, when you were to eat, first of all, Jews would not touch Gentiles that are non-Christians because they thought they would be defiled. So much less, here's Jesus hanging out inside of a house with this whole room of all these people. And they say, why does he eat with such scum? And then that culture in the Jewish traditions, they believe that when they would eat, you know, they would all lay around, they wouldn't have tables back then or silverware. They would lay a rug out and then they'd have a bunch of sauces and pita bread. They dip the pita bread, they eat it. And in that custom, they believe that when you were to eat, you would become one. So here, because the salivas, you mix the salivas. And you know what I'm talking about. Like when you go eat chips and salsa with someone and you see like that one that's floating in there that looks soggy and you're like, did that come out of someone's mouth? Like someone was already chewing and it's already soggy and then, yeah, so it goes inside. You're like, dude, that's disgusting. Get that thing out of here. Or was this just a chip that just broke off and now it's soggy? But you ain't taking the chance. You're like, get that thing out of here. These guys back then, they obviously had no problem because pita bread falls apart so easy. Can you imagine how much soggy pita bread and all that in there? Disgusting. I'm so glad I live in these times. So here they are. Here they are, and these guys, the religious leaders, are looking at Jesus hanging out with these sinners. How could he eat with such scum? And it does not say that any of them gave their life to Jesus. Jesus was breaking bread, hanging out with them in a very dark place with crazy conversations going on. Do your friends ever, just because you're a Christian, do your friends change the way they talk? No. Maybe some, oh, I'm sorry, bro. Like, shut up, relax. Come on. Relax, I don't drink, you know, drink. I don't care. But most of the time, I don't know when I go out and hang out with my friends. No, I was just with my friends the other day. Everyone's getting high, telling me about how much they just like did 2 8-balls of cocaine over the weekend. One guy was coming off ecstasy or Molly, they call it. They're not changing their deal. That's what they are. That's who they are. And I was just there letting my light shine. They're like, you're sober now? I'm like, yeah. Like, how long? I'm like, 9 years. What? go, you still smoke, so you still smoke, right? I'm all, no, man. What? I mean, it's like full on, but you know what? I'm gonna close here in a second, but really quick is, I didn't share this with the other two services, but I got to meet up and hang out with them, and I was out with them for like 10 hours. And I'm like, God, what do you want to do? You know, I'm not coming up here to preach. I'm just let my light shine. And then at the end, he told me, you know, we were talking about, you know, they're into conspiracy theory. They smoke a lot of weed, you know, conspiracies, you know. So I started talking about destroy all God stuff, you know, CERN and all these, you know, witchcraft and all stuff. And I said, yeah, man, I took like 15 hits of ecstasy this one time. And I had a bunch of cocaine. And I had these like demons like show up in my room, you know. And all of a sudden, the whole atmosphere changed. Everyone was like looking at me. And I was like, And then one guy goes, dude, he's like, every time I try going sober, he's like, dude, these black figures show up in my room and like hold me down. And then the other girl goes, oh my gosh, she goes, I've been seeing like these little girls since I was young. And then as I got older, they turn into like demons and stuff. She's like, just the other night, there was a demon on top of me trying to have sex with me. And then this other girl goes like, oh my gosh, from the other room. Oh my gosh, what are you guys talking about? And I'm all, what's up? Are you freaked out? She goes, no, I grew up in a haunted house my whole life. So basically, in this room with eight people, my homies, eight people, and I'm there, six to seven of them are having demon encounters. Is that it? Dude, that's the world we live in, right? Well, no doubt, drugs and alcohol and all this stuff, important, you're going to end up in that situation. These are my friends that I grew up with, like that we were in the same thing, doing it the same. So as I talk about that, I go, hey, you guys, you know what? I said, dude, check this out. I don't have that anymore. You know why? Because I follow Jesus. The girl's like, are you religious? I'm like, no. I go, I read the Bible and I follow Jesus' teaching. Like, you go to church every Sunday? In my mind, I'm like, I teach the Bible. I didn't say anything. I'm like, yeah, I go every Sunday. No way. I go, yeah, it's a relationship I have. I'm not religious. And I go, check this out. I go, there's power in God's name. Yeah, I go, his name is Jesus. Yeah? I said, dude, you don't have to have that stuff anymore. And I go, hey, and then my Crystal's texting me. She's already texted me an hour ago. I forgot to tell you that. She texted me, hey, come home. It's your turn. It's your shift. But then the Holy Spirit led me to open up about the demon thing. So that opened up this conversation. I go, guys, I'm on baby watch. I got to bounce. And I'm in Hollywood, so I got to go back. I'm staying at my parents right now. So I said, look, I'm gonna come back next week. Dude, you gotta come back. We wanna hear more about this stuff. Oh, dude, I love to talk to you guys about this stuff. I go, I got info for days. I study about this stuff. So now I'm going back this Wednesday. But the religious people, Pharisees in the church, would go, why is he hanging out with such scum? They're not scum. Jesus loves these people. Jesus loves these people. This is why he came. He came because he loves these people so much that he died for them. If Jesus didn't love them, do you think he would give his life for them? He loves them so much, he came on a rescue mission for me and for them and for you. And this is what he says in verse 17. When Jesus heard this, these guys are being peeping Toms. They're like looking out the window, trying to find problems with Jesus. Judging from the computer on Instagram, trying to watch everything that the Whosoever Movement is doing to judge, to find flaw. We don't care. We don't care about you Pharisees. And I'm not saying you guys. This is for the Pharisees that are going to watch it on YouTube. Because they study me. Study me. I follow Jesus. Learn and do what I do, like Jesus. So he heard this and he told them, healthy people don't need a doctor. Sick people do. I have come to call not those who think they are righteous. He's not looking for the people that think they got it all figured out. You aren't on his radar. The people that are like, yeah, dude, I'm a Christian, hardcore Christian, man. God's changed me and I haven't done anything with my life, but I know all the words in Greek and Hebrew and I can judge everyone real good. It's sad when you have a critical spirit and you put your place on the throne where you're God and you're judging people's intentions and their hearts. Who knows the heart? God knows the heart. That is sin. So here he says, I didn't come for you guys that think you're righteous Pharisees, but those who know they are sinners. That's our Jesus. Knows who they're sinners. In another gospel, he says this, I want you guys, in Matthew, he tells those guys, I want you guys to show mercy, not sacrifice. I don't want your dead religion. I want mercy. What's mercy? When you, some of you guys have DUIs like me and you got in some trouble with the court and you show up in court and you're like, God, just judge, please have mercy. You know what mercy means? You're guilty, but you get what you don't deserve. So he tells these guys, I want mercy. I don't want your stupid sacrifice. I don't want your religion. And to back this stuff up, here's the read a couple scriptures in closing. In Jude 1, 20 through 23, it says this, but you, dear friends, must build each other in the most holy faith, pray in the power of the Holy Spirit, and await the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will bring you eternal life. In this way, you will keep yourself safe in God's love, key love, in God's love. And you must show mercy to those whose faith is wavering. Show mercy again. Whose faith is wavering, show mercy, what they don't deserve. You know, they might be like, oh, I was a Christian, or oh, you Christians this and that. Show mercy, love, to whose faith is wavering. Rescue others by snatching them up out of the flames of judgment. In the King James, it says the flames of fire. That means you have to be hell-bent, which means reckless, to determine to go to the gates of hell, and you're going to have to snatch them out. If you're gonna reach them out of hell, you're going to have to be at the gates of hell to snatch them out. And guess what? You're going to smell like smoke. People are going to look at you and go, why are you there? But if you're going to reach those ones, you're going to have to go to the gates of hell to reach them. And this is scripture backing it up. And then it says, show mercy to others, but still with great caution, hating the sins that contaminate their lives. Be in the world, but not of the world. Don't go along with it. Be set apart by the power of the Holy Spirit. Follow the Holy Ghost, not the cool ghost. Mark 12, 29, 30 says, Jesus replied, the most important commandment is this. Listen, O Israel, to God's people. The Lord our God is the one and only Lord, and you must love the Lord God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength. The second is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself. There's no other commandments that are greater than these. I don't know about you guys, but I have no Christian neighbors. But I know for me, I want a relationship with Jesus. I want God to use me. I want to go to heaven. I want God to bless my life. And it's saying, love your neighbor as yourself. That means we should be looking at our neighbors and our family and wanting the best for them and to show mercy and to love them. And then 1 Peter 4:8, it says this, most important of all, continue to show deep love for each other, for love covers a multitude of sins. We got to love and not judge. In James, it says that the tongue is set on fire by hell itself. You can bless people or you can curse people. It can't be tamed, it says. It says this is a small little thing in your body, but it's untamable. It's insane. And it will change the course and the direction of people's lives. If you are constantly coming against people and judging people when they hear it, you're tearing them down, God's children. Or you can lift them up. We got to all love people. And it's a hard one to do sometimes. But we got to do it. And in closing with this last verse, John 17, Jesus prayed this to the Father God. This is before he was going to the cross. And it was for the disciples. And it extends to us because we're his disciples as well. He says this, I'm not asking you to take them out of the world, but to keep them safe from the evil one. They do not belong to this world any more than I do. Make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word, which is truth. Just as you sent me into the world, I am sending them into the world. God sent Jesus Christ, his son, into the world for the lost. And he says, just like you sent me in, Father, now I'm sending them out. We have to reach the lost at any cost. We have to give our lives as a living sacrifice. We have to deny ourselves, our fleshly body appetites, and align our lives with God's will so that we could pour our lives out as a liquid offering to Jesus. And God will use us to bring people to Christ through love. And before I walk off the stage, if there's anyone here that needs to receive Jesus Christ in their life or give their life back to God, stick a thumb up. And I want to pray for you before I leave here today.